It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Not much this government does surprises me anymore, but when I learned that reporter Brian Lilly had an FOI that showed the Premier handed out two contracts worth nearly $1 million to David Hurley and his company, the Gandalf Group, I was shocked. Let's not be mistaken, this is the same David Hurley who co-chaired the Premier's election campaign. And that is the same Gandalf Group that is the Liberals' personal and preferred polling company. David Hurley is being rewarded for his political work with nearly $1 million of taxpayers' money. Mr. Speaker, does the Premier have an ounce of ethics left? Does the Premier think it is acceptable to hand out $1 million worth of contracts to her Liberal pals and cronies? Does the Premier think that's acceptable?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And the member opposite will know that market research and polling companies have been used by governments traditionally, Mr. Speaker. In fact, there are at least six other companies, Mr. Speaker, that have contracts: Forum Research, Ipsos Reid, Strategic Council, Ecos Research, and Veronix Harris Decima all have contracts with government, Mr. Speaker. All of that market research, the public opinion research conducted by the government, is procured through a fair and transparent competitive process. Every company has to be qualified, has to be a vendor of record, Mr. Speaker, and has to compete for a project with no fewer than five competitors. And then the final decision about which vendor is best suited for a project is made by a committee of at least three nonpartisan public servants. That's the process that all companies undergo, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. The Liberals and this Premier will do absolutely anything to hold on to power. The only thing the Liberals care about is their own political survival. The FOI showed that there was one contract that towered above all others. That was the contract to David Hurley and the Gandalf Group. This wasn't a normal government tender. The money came directly from the Cabinet Office, essentially the Premier's personal slush fund. Mr. Speaker, this information was only revealed because of an FOI.
Order.
I shouldn't have to ask, but I will. How many other of these contracts are there? How many more contracts is the Premier hiding? Can the Premier tell this legislature how many contracts her government and all the ministries have they given to David Hurley?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I said, there is a process whereby any polling or marketing research is procured, Mr. Speaker. All governments, including former NDP and PC governments, have conducted market research, Mr. Speaker. And it's market research that allows us, for example, to understand the impact of a campaign like the Who Will You Help campaign,
Order.
Mr. Speaker, the ad campaign that is demonstrably changing attitudes about sexual assault and violence.
I may have to move quickly if I'm not going to get response when I ask for a generic order. I might move to individuals very quickly. Carry on.
Just on that campaign, Mr. Speaker, we know that before the campaign, 37% of Ontarians felt they had an obligation to intervene when witnessed.
Oh, the member from Leeds-Grenville, come to order. Carry on.
37% felt they had an obligation to intervene when witnessing sexual harassment, Mr. Speaker, but Ipsos Reid did a survey, and now we know that that number has increased to 58%,
Answer.
So we understand that there actually has been an impact. That's the kind of market research that
Thank
we've done,
you.
Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, there's about a million reasons why no one in Ontario is going to believe this spin. The Premier has no Cabinet Minister to blame for this. The Cabinet Office is under her direction. David Hurley is her precious friend. This was her decision to make. The Cabinet Office shouldn't be the personal piggy bank for the Premier's cronies, even if you call it a process. The Premier can't hide behind this was not an open and transparent process. According to Brian Lilly, senior Liberals who know how the Cabinet Office works disputed the idea this process was completely nonpartisan and not subject to the political direction directly from the Premier. So that means the Premier directed nearly $1 million to her friend. Wow. Look up at the parents today, Madam Premier. That money could have gone a long way to help the children with autism. Mr. Speaker, this might just be the tip of the iceberg. Mr. Speaker, I repeat, how many other contracts like this are there? It is.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Governments do market research. Governments do market research to discover and find the indications of the impact of their policies,
spend the
Mr.
Money
Speaker.
Too.
Forum and Research has contracts across government, Mr. Speaker, of more than $2 million. Ipsos Reid of nearly $2 million, Mr. Speaker. Yeah. Strategic Council, $373,000, Mr. Speaker. Ecos Research, $172,000. Environics, $164,000. Harris Decima, $122,000. Mr. Yeah. Speaker, the fact is governments of all stripes do market research. It's responsible to do so. Those decisions are made in terms of a process that is competitive, Mr. Speaker. There have to be five vendors. A choice is made by public servants, Mr. Speaker. It's not a partisan process. And, Mr. Speaker, as I say, governments across all political stripes do market research.
New question? The leader of the third party.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the government can heckle all they want, but I was disgusted when I heard the member from Mississauga Streetsville heckle last week and said Melanie Pelipon should have answered the phone. To blame his slow-motion apology on Melanie Pelipon not being able to answer the phone is absurd. Did the member consider for even a second that Melanie was with her son who has autism instead of waiting by the phone for this slow-motion apology? Did he consider that Melanie might have had to take care of her son Xavier with therapy, or she simply needed to be with him? None of this is Melanie's fault. In the end, the responsibility rests with two people, the member and the Premier. Mr. Speaker, one of those two people has belatedly apologized. Will the Premier apologize to Melanie Pelipon?
Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I've been very clear that our job as members of this legislature, as representatives of community, is to work with our constituents, to talk with our constituents, Mr. Speaker. And I apologize to constituents who feel that they have not been able to access a member. But, Mr. Speaker, we have, on this side of the House, been talking to parents consistently. The member has apologized for this particular incident, Mr. Speaker, and my understanding is that he is working to set up a meeting with the family. Mr. Speaker, the changes that we are making, the additional $333 million that we are putting into the autism program, Mr. Speaker, is to help children who have been sitting on waiting lists, who have not been getting service, to go through a transition. We want every child in the province who has autism to have the service that they need, to have the intensity of service that they need, and to have in a seamless transition, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. I want the Premier to think about Dallas from Barrie. She is the mother of Mitchell, who has autism. Dallas's life is consumed by taking care of Mitchell and her other kids. There is nothing she loves more, but her dedication means Dallas can't work and therefore is a one-income family struggling to get by. They do their best to help Mitchell and her other children, but it has led to some tough decisions. For the last month, they've had to shut off their gas at their house. That means no hot water, no warm showers. Mr. Speaker, I still don't understand how the Liberal government can turn their backs on these families. How can the Liberals do this to Dallas and families like hers?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, the entire reason that we are investing more than $330 million additional dollars into the program is to make sure that kids who are sitting on a list not getting service will get service. So all of the Dallases and the Mitchells in Ontario, Mr. Speaker, they are exactly the people that we are working with to try to make sure that they get the service that they need. So far, 545 of 900 families have had a meeting with their service providers, Mr. Speaker, to work through the transition to make sure that they are moving into service that previously they would not have been able to access. That is the point of the transition, Mr. Speaker. I understand it's a change. I understand that it's a challenge. That's why every family is going to be working to make sure that they're getting the service that they need and they go through a transition so that their children, so that their children aren't sitting on a waiting list not getting service, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the new money is a shell game. This is a cut. 2,200 kids are kicked off the list. And there may be new money 2 years down the road.
Stop the button. Come to order. Member from Etobicoke North.
Mr. Speaker, this new money hypothetically might kick in 2 years from now. The families are out of luck today, but it's not too late. Look at the parents of these children here today. 93% of the children currently getting IBI treatment are older than 5 years old. Now they'll have their treatment taken away. Many of those children and their parents will be outside protesting those cuts. The Premier autism doesn't end at 5. Neither should the IBI treatment. Mr. Speaker, today the Premier can make a difference to thousands of families. She can do the right thing. Mr. Speaker, very clear question. Will the Premier announce today that she will reverse the cuts and honour these families, do the right thing, and fund IBI?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Order. Start the clock. Order. I will. I'm now ready to move on to warnings, if that's what you want. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, these are some of the most vulnerable kids in the province, and we know that, and that's exactly why it is so important that all of these kids get the service and the treatment that they need. It is so important for these families, Mr. Speaker.
Member from Dufferin-Caledon, come to order.
That's why the meetings with the families, the work on the transition is happening right now. You know, I need to make sure that the Leader of the Opposition understands that this is a new $330+ million, Mr. Speaker. This is money on top of $190 million that is already in place, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of Finance.
This kind of investment is the kind of investment that his party consistently votes against,
Mr. Speaker.
But we know that it's very important that we make these investments now because there are children who have been sitting on waiting lists while the biological window closes for intensive treatment when it's most effective. We need to get that money to the kids now, get the service now, help the families through the transition so that those kids can flourish.
Absolutely.
That's what this is about.
New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Speaker, IBI therapy can change a child's life. To the Premier, Speaker. IBI therapy can change a child's life. It can mean the difference between a child with autism being able to communicate with the world around them or not. Autism doesn't end at 5, Speaker, and neither should IBI therapy. Parents are making their fourth trip in 4 months to call on the Premier to stop her cuts to autism therapy. Will this Premier listen to those parents this time, Speaker?
Thank you.
Here.
So, Mr. Speaker, investing a new $330+ million is not a cut, Mr. Speaker. Yeah. That is an additional, additional funding. It's a huge investment, Mr. Speaker. And you know, we know that autism doesn't end at five, Mr. Speaker. We know that it is extremely important that children get tailor-made programs that meet their needs, Mr. Speaker. You know, I look up into the galleries and I see families who are dealing with kids with autism who love those kids and want to make sure they get service. That's exactly why we're putting this new money into the system. I also see providers in the gallery, Mr. Speaker, who understand how important it is that you have a tailor-made program for children. That's what this is about. That's what this transition is about,
Answer.
Mr. Speaker. That's why more than $330 million is being invested so all of those kids can get the service that they need.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, I'm sure that most of the parents here at Queen's Park would rather be at work, would rather be with their kids or engaged in their normal day-to-day activities, Speaker. But instead, they've traveled to Queen's Park from all across Ontario for the fourth time in 4 months to fight for their kids and their kids' futures. And for showing dedication to their children, they have had the police called on them by the member for Mississauga-Streetsville and again this weekend by the Liberal Party of Ontario at their nomination meeting in Scarborough. The Premier forced her MPP from Mississauga-Streetsville to apologize to these parents. Will she now do the right thing as the leader of the Ontario Liberal Party and issue an apology to the parents of children with autism who had the police called on them yesterday by her party?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, it's very important to me that people who have something to say publicly have the opportunity to say it. Mr. Speaker, I asked the question this morning whether the Liberal Party had called the police during the nomination meeting. That was not the case, Mr. Speaker. It was just not true. There was a traffic control and a crowd control issue. And, Mr. Speaker, when there are large gatherings, that often happens that police need to be involved. The point is, Mr. Speaker, that the parents who felt that they needed to express themselves had the opportunity to do so as people went into the nomination meeting, Mr. Speaker. You know, in terms of listening to parents, it is extremely important to me that the parents in the audience understand that we have been doing that. And I'll give a perfect example, Mr. Speaker. The whole issue around direct funding, which has come up in all of the meetings that I have had with parents and that the minister has had, and I know many of my members, we are looking at direct funding as an option, Mr. Speaker, as something that we need to do more of, and I'll say more about that in supplementary.
Yep. No supplementary.
Children across Ontario should be getting the supports they need so that they can succeed, so they can express themselves and be fully engaged in their families, in school, be able to grow up and achieve their goals. As one mother said when she visited Queen's Park, without the therapy that her son needs, quote, "I will never know what his true potential was or what it could have been," end quote. Autism does not end at five, and the need for IBI therapy for some children does not end at five either, Speaker, regardless of what the Liberals are trying to tell parents with children of autism today and have been telling them since they brought the new program forward. IBI therapy simply should not be arbitrarily ended at five by this government or any other government, Speaker. So will this Premier do the right thing and stop calling the police and instead ensure that children with autism have the therapy that they need to reach their full potential?
Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, that's it.
Proceed, please. Thank you. Premier.
That's exactly why we're making this investment, Mr. Speaker. That's exactly why children need to go through an assessment. And, Mr. Speaker, as I said in my previous answer, as we talk with parents, as we talk to the Coalition and the Alliance, Mr. Speaker, it's clear to me that as we look at the options, we need to look more carefully at the direct funding option. You know, the $8,000 that is going to many parents to go through this transition, that is a form of direct funding, and we need to look at continuing that, Mr. Speaker. Speaker, as one of the options. And of course, the intensity of IBI doesn't end for the need for intense treatment like IBI doesn't end, Mr. Speaker, for some children. But that's why we need to have an assessment. And as Dr. Peter Zatmari said, Mr. Speaker, who's the Chief of Child and Youth Mental Health Collaborative between CAMH, SickKids, and U of T, and I quote, "It is so important to personalize intervention services for children with ASD." That is the point. Personalizing it, Mr. Speaker, putting more money in so that more children can have the service that they need.
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the First Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. You know, it took several weeks of pressure by opposition parties, editorial writers, and experts, but the Prime Minister of Canada has listened and agreed not to ram through changes to Canada's election laws using his parliamentary majority. Will the Premier of Ontario follow the Prime Minister's lead and agree not to use a parliamentary majority to ram through changes to how Ontario's democracy is funded and agree to a committee structure similar to the one approved in Ottawa?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, you know, I know that the leader of the third party knows that there is a difference between these issues. On the one hand, you're dealing with an issue in terms of electoral reform that is where there is no consensus, Mr. Speaker, where it's highly contentious. There are no models that there's a consensus on across the country. Whereas when we talk about fundraising reform, Mr. Speaker, there are models. There's a large degree of consensus. We can look at the federal model, Mr. Speaker. We can look to other provinces, and we know where that consensus is, Mr. Speaker. Now we want to go out and consult on the draft legislation, make sure that we get input, and we hope that the third party will take part in that process in a full and collaborative way.
Yeah.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, in Ottawa and in here in Ontario, Liberal governments are changing how our democracies work. In Ottawa, the Liberals agreed that the committee changing the rules would have to work collaboratively, and no party could make any unilateral changes. Now, apparently, the Prime Minister of Canada understands the fundamental making of a democracy and how important it is for all parties to be engaged. Will the Liberal government here at Queen's Park follow the lead of the federal Liberal government, put aside the interests of the Liberal Party of Ontario, and agree that one party shouldn't be able to make unilateral changes to the basics of our democracy?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, the Leader of the Third Party will remember that when we went through the electoral reform process here in Ontario, yeah, there was a select committee, Mr. Speaker. There were citizens' assemblies held across the province, Mr. Speaker, and there was a referendum in which the entire population of Ontario took part, Mr. Speaker, because on that issue there was not consensus, Mr. Speaker. There was a high degree of contention around different models, and we determined that that was the that was the process that needed to be undertaken, and it was. There is a broad consensus across party lines, Mr. Speaker, and across jurisdictions on fundraising rules. We are now working to reform the fundraising rules to catch up, in fact, to other jurisdictions, Mr. Speaker. We look forward to all of the input that we'll get in the consultation around the province, and we hope, as I say, unlike to this point, we hope that the third party will take part and will do so in a collaborative manner.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier and the government seem intent on a reform process that will serve the best interests of the Ontario Liberal Party rather than the people of Ontario, a process that will have little credibility outside the Liberal caucus room. We can actually change that, Speaker. It is never too late to do the right thing. New Democrats are putting a motion forward this afternoon offering a constructive solution, a committee made up of 4 Liberals, 3 Conservatives, 2 New Democrats and 1 Green Party member. That structure actually reflects the vote, the popular vote in 2014, and would ensure that any amendments at committee would have to have the support of at least 2 parties in order to pass. So, will the Premier of this province keep the deck stacked in favour of the Liberal Party?
Question.
Or will she actually do the right thing and agree today to making our democracy more democratic?
Thank you.
Well, Speaker, this is nothing but deflection on part of the NDP, because one thing has become very clear out of this entire process, that there's one party is definitely entrenched in protecting the status quo, Speaker, and that is the New Democratic Party of Ontario, Speaker. Because at every stage of the process, Speaker, they have thrown more hurdles, more objections than anybody else. They refuse to engage.
The Deputy House Leader will stop taking advantage of a turned-on microphone. Second time.
That's a new tactic.
And I can't believe that you're talking while I'm standing. Carry on.
Speaker, NDP refused to engage in a democratic process by which we have an opportunity to consult with Ontarians. They have voted against a motion that will allow members of this legislature to work all through the summer, visit as many towns and cities in this great province to hear from Ontarians.
Answer.
As to what kind of electoral financing reforms you need to do. Speaker, NDP needs to leave their status quo behind, stop doing private fundraisers, and engage in a consultative process so that we can reform.
Thank you. New question, member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you. My question is to the Premier. As of last month, Kelly McDowell's daughter has been kicked out of IBI therapy and is now on a waiting list for ABA. Let me repeat. Kelly's daughter has been kicked off of IBI and is now on a waiting list. Kelly's daughter and thousands like her will have to wait for the minister's new program using a service that is known to be not as effective as IBI. After almost 40 questions, 4 rallies and numerous debates, will the minister reverse her decision and allow children over the age of 5 to access IBI therapy?
Minister of Children, Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to thank my critic for the question. And I also want to take this opportunity to acknowledge the parents that are here and folks from the Alliance and the Coalition. It's been very valuable and important to hear their voice as we move forward, as the Premier and I have indicated. There is room for input and ideas in moving the new program forward, and we are taking action, Speaker. On a number of fronts, including establishing the Autism Implementation Committee. And that's a very important advisory committee, Speaker, where the voices of parents and clinicians and advocates, and I want the voice of youth there, either directly or indirectly, working with our child advocate to make sure we get this right, Speaker. And when it comes to children who have been in IBI therapy, we know, Speaker, that it is the decision of a clinician to determine the plan going forward, and that we will make sure that families
Member from
have
Hamilton
right
Mountain,
support,
second time.
Whatever what that clinical
Thank you.
Assessment is. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Your idea of support is putting children back on wait lists. It's not working. The experts aren't paying. They don't believe you. The parents don't believe you. The children don't believe you. The child and youth advocate doesn't believe you. Do the right thing, Minister. One concern wrote the minister and the premier, and she said, "You say you have a new program that will be up and running in 2018. So why is it our children can't remain where they are until that program is up and running? You say your MPPs and the agencies are giving parents all the information that will make this transition as smooth as possible. If you honestly think you are getting the information, then you truly do live in a world of fantasies. Parents want to see a real plan, not one that leaves them stranded until 2018. I ask the minister again, please
Question.
Reverse your decision and allow children over the age of 5 access to IBI. Just do it.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
So, Speaker, it's important to mention that every single family affected by this transition is receiving communication from their service provider. As the Premier already mentioned, over 545 affected families have had those meetings. And, Speaker, the things they are talking about include the go-forward treatment plan, what services to use, and how to use their direct funding, if they're eligible for that. And, Speaker, it's also important to know that families can continue to access a range of programs that have already been in place, whether that is rehab services, respite services, March and summer break camps, and other programs offered through Autism Ontario. Once families whose child has come off the IBI list and they've exhausted the direct payment of $8,000, we are going to work very hard to make sure they move quickly into directly.
Thank you. New question. The member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Parents of children with autism have come to Queen's Park yet again, begging this government to listen to their concerns. The government continues to say that no child is being removed from service and therapy, that every child will move into immediate service. I just want to be clear. Just because you say something over and over and over again doesn't make it true. We have sued the discharge letters.
Stop clock. Finish, please.
We have seen the discharge letters. On this side of the House, we know that every child matters, that all children, regardless of age, should have access to services that we know that they need to thrive. Will the Premier listen to a coalition of voices coming out against her plan to remove children over the age of 5 from IBI therapy and the waiting list?
Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, our plan is to move children into the service that they need. Our plan is to help kids who are not getting service to get service.
Member from Dufferin-Caledon, second time.
Our plan is to have 16,000 children who are not getting service to get service, Mr. Speaker. I understand that we are in the midst of a transition right now. I understand that children and families are being asked to go from one process to another. But, Mr. Speaker, our plan is to help kids who are not getting service to get the service that they need, and our plan is to make sure that children who are getting service continue to get the intensity of service that they need. That's our plan. That's why $330+ million is being put into the system, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that children across the province get the service that they need.
Thank you. Supplementary.
She can call her whatever she likes, but her government made a mess of this plan, and parents are here to tell you it again. About priorities. Internal documents revealed that almost 80% of the Liberals' so-called historic investment won't happen until after the next election. The sham of this government's new autism program is that it promises more money, but it actually delays investment while forcing thousands of families to sacrifice their children's future. This government is actually taking away service from children over the age of 5 while having no plan to make substantial investments until after 2018. It's not just about the opposition that is begging you to listen. It's a broad coalition of voices. Please, Premier, please do the right thing. Please make the decision to grandfather these kids, give them the service that they so desperately need.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Children Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And, you know, to me, the current wait times are unacceptable. The long spaces, the wait times for therapy, that's unacceptable, Speaker. We are taking children off wait lists that are going to grow to about 5 years by 2018 and getting them some immediate therapy support. We are looking at our options going forward, whether that's direct funding or other services, and we are very appreciative of those voices that have come forward, and they are actually helping us and offering to be part of the Autism Advisory Implementation Committee, and that's going to happen very soon. Meanwhile, Speaker, My commitment is to the families, to all the families with children who are affected, to make sure they get the information they need from their service provider, from this government, so that those children feel well supported
Thank you.
Through this transition.
Right. Your question, the member from the Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services. Minister, I know that you're hard at work on the transformation of corrections in Ontario, adding X-ray body scanners to every institution over the next 2 years, hiring more staff, and developing new mental health training for our correctional officers are all important steps that will improve conditions for staff and inmates. Last year, you announced the construction of a regional intermittent centre at the Elgin Middlesex Detention Centre, designed to house intermittent offenders, which, when operational, will add new capacity to the correctional system. After the success of the Toronto Intermittent Centre in my riding of Etobicoke Lakeshore in reducing contraband and improving security at the Toronto South Detention Centre, I'm pleased to see that the government is moving ahead with the building of this intermittent centre in Elgin Middlesex in London. Mr. Speaker, through you, can the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services please provide an update on the work that's taking place at the Elgin Middlesex Detention Centre?
Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore. Speaker, my most important priority as Minister is the safety and security of our staff and inmates. That is why, as part of our transformation of corrections, we have been constructing a 112-bed regional intermittent centre on the grounds of the Elgin Middlesex Detention Centre in London, Ontario. This new centre builds on the success of the Toronto Intermittent Centre and is the next step in our strategy for intermittent offenders who are serving 90-day sentences, typically on weekends. Housing intermittent offenders in their own facility will help to continue to improve conditions at EMDC. For example, it's an efficient and dedicated way to address capacity pressure by increasing the number of available beds, cutting down on overcrowding, and improving staff and inmate safety. Speaker, also a separate facility will help prevent contraband from being introduced into the main facility by intermittent offenders that return to their communities during the week. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services for the answer. I know that all Ontarians, and specifically those in Southern Ontario, will be happy to learn about this new facility being built at the Elgin Middlesex Detention Centre and that it will be soon operational. This will be an important step in continuing to improve conditions in our institutions related to capacity and also, along with the addition of an X-ray body scanner, will help reduce contraband. But Minister, I've heard you say in the past that the transformation of corrections can't be about building more jails, that it needs to be about finally breaking the cycle of reoffending. Members of my community and Ontarians across the province know that is what will make our communities a safer place. So, Mr. Speaker, through you, can the minister please provide an update on what he is doing to transform corrections in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister.
Speaker, the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore is absolutely right. Building safer communities across Ontario can be about building more jails. It needs to be about actually reducing the demand for our jails. That means, Speaker, we need to work closely together with all of our correction partners to look at evidence-based solutions to the improvements that need to be made. Putting correctional back into the correctional system means working to break the cycle of reoffending. That is why we are focused on increasing rehabilitation programming in our correctional facilities. Speaker, we are also working closely with our community and correctional partners to deliver this important programming. That is also why we are conducting a thorough review of our segregation policy, Speaker, to ensure that segregation is truly used as a last resort. These are transformational changes, and they will not happen overnight. But I can say that we are working closely with all of our corrections partners to improve our system
and build
the safer communities for all. Thank you, Speaker.
New question, the member from Halliburton, Forth and Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Week after week, there are human trafficking incidences reported across the province. In 2011, this government touted a paltry investment of $1.95 million over 3 years. But an FOI revealed that of the $1.95 million, the Ministry of the Attorney General only invested $190,000
in community agencies, specifically for victims of human trafficking between 2011 and 2013. In 2011, Manitoba invested $8 million in its anti-trafficking programs. It is shameful that this government barely invested $200,000, which is less than what a trafficker can profit from just one victim in a year.
Oh my goodness.
Mr. Speaker, will the Premier now admit that the insulting amount that was promised was actually never even spent?
Minister responsible for women's issues.
Minister responsible for women's issues.
Thank you, Speaker. I know one of my colleagues will want to share on the supplementary with me, but I do appreciate the question because, as the member opposite knows, the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services are bringing forward a human traffic strategy this month, and it is very important we do that because of the serious nature of this issue and the complexity of it. And we have held a number of consultations on human trafficking across the province. We've looked at what we're investing already, Speaker, in terms of human trafficking. We do that at the community level. We do that at provincial level. I know the Minister of Community and Social Services and the Minister for Community Safety and Correctional Services has a number of programs they already invest, as does the Attorney General in terms
Answer.
Of supporting victims of human trafficking. I'm very pleased that we're going to bring this forward. It's going to be very survivor-focused, and we are going to...
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, look, a trafficker preys, manipulates, drugs, and assaults their victims who are, on average, 14 years old. That's the reality. They are our children. It's the largest growing crime. It's more profitable than guns or drugs.
What a heartbreak.
The girls next door are reusable commodities, and make no mistake, they are brutalized over and over. If past history predicts future behavior, it's clear that the government's strategy will not have any meaningful investment. The 2016 budget confirms there is no new money. It is not building Ontario up. It's tearing the lives of our children apart. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, how much longer will our girls continue to be abandoned by
First
this government?
Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
To the Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, human trafficking is a tragedy, and my ministry takes it very seriously. So we have invested in 2011, my ministry committed $1.75 million over 3 years as part of an initiative to combat human trafficking. So funding went towards programs that support victims of human trafficking and the development of province-wide online training program for frontline services providers working with victims of human trafficking. The remainder of the fund were used for existing victim support programs and services, and to some that these services are available to victims of human trafficking. This government, Mr. Speaker, are investing and will continue to invest, contrary at what they have done when they were in power. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Public dollars are being used for partisan advertising in this province. The Auditor General saw a recent ad and said she had concluded that the primary objective of this ad is to foster a positive impression of the government. This ad would not have passed her review prior to the Act's amendments on June 6, 2015. This Premier is planning to restrict political advertising on just about every issue in the 6 months prior to the election campaigns going forward. Why is partisan government advertising the exception?
Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'll remind the member opposite actually that we're the government that brought in legislation around partisan advertising, Mr. Speaker, and we brought it in because of the practices of the previous government, Mr. Speaker, where the Premier of the day was front and center in.
Premier.
where the Premier of the day was front and centre in, as Mr. Speaker. It is true, giving people information about what this government is doing, Mr. Speaker. The Climate Change Act, Mr. Speaker, is an extremely important piece of public information, Mr. Speaker. You know, I think that it would be hard to argue that action on climate change is a partisan issue, Mr. Speaker. And if the NDP wants to argue that taking action on climate change is a liberal initiative, so be it, Mr. Speaker. It's the greatest threat to speak.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm glad the Premier mentioned climate change, because if a group of concerned citizens wanted to run an advertisement 6 months before an election saying all parties need to do more about climate change, they would face significant restrictions by her government. If a group of parents wanted to run advertisements months before an election saying that children with autism need better supports, they would face significant restrictions. Wow. But if the government runs ads that the Auditor General says are essentially self-promotion, they can spend as much as they want, completely drowning anyone else out. This seems like it is more about shutting down anyone criticizing the Liberals than it is about election fairness. Why does this Premier plan to clamp down on nonpartisan advertising by advocacy groups and citizens of this province, but she will continue to allow the government to spend as much as it wants on partisan advertising?
Question. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, it's very interesting that how NDP is choosing to debate the draft legislation that is before the committee for public hearing here in the legislature, while they have refused at every stage of the process to engage and participate and give their feedback when that draft legislation was written, Speaker. Speaker, that is why we have taken the unprecedented step of taking the draft legislation and has referred that legislation, Speaker, to the committee after first reading. It has not yet even been debated in the House, Speaker, so that we can hear from Ontarians across the province and be able to improve upon the legislation, the draft bill, Speaker. I urge the member that I hope she stops worrying about her vacation planning while what she has been talking about in the committee, and actually take the time and travel the province, listen to experts, listen to Ontarians, so that we can amend that bill, we can make it stronger, and bring it back here in September for second reading debate. Thank you, Speaker.
New question, the member from Trinity Spadina.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Transportation. Last year today, our government launched the Union Pearson Express, the first of its kind in Ontario. The UP Express has been providing reliable and efficient service for those looking to travel between Union Station and the Pearson International Airport. Since its launch date, however, we've received some criticism from media and the opposition members about the services. Some has been concerned about the price of fares, some has been concerned about the low ridership, and still others been concerned about the use of service more generally. Mr. Speaker, with today marking the first year anniversary of launching the Union Pearson Express, can the minister please provide members of this House with a ridership update?
Good question.
Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker. I want to begin by thanking the member from Trinity Spadina for that wonderful question. Today does mark the one-year anniversary, Speaker, of the launch of the Union Pearson Express, a service that our government is rightly very proud of. This is a service, Speaker, to remind the House, that was delivered both on time and on budget. And since the Union Pearson Express launch in 2015, it continues to offer passengers predictable and reliable service to and from the airport with stops along the way. Speaker, members of this House will recall that we announced a new fare structure earlier this year, and we are already seeing positive results with this change. The ridership has doubled in the first few weeks following the announcement of the new fare structure, Speaker, tripled within 6 weeks, and now, more than 3 months later, we are seeing averages of 8,200 riders per weekday on the Union Pearson Express, Speaker. Speaker, ridership continues to increase week over week, thanks to the action that we've taken and thanks to the advocacy of a number of members on this side of the House.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank the minister for his response, and those living in my community of Trinity Spadina will be very happy to hear that 8,200 people a day are choosing to use the UP Express. I know the UP Express was originally launched to provide air travelers with efficient service to the Pearson Airport. However, last week, due to some TTC services issues, many in my community chose to take UP Express to get to work on time. Mr. Speaker, now that the fare for staff between Pearson and Union are better aligned with the existing GO fares, I believe that more and more commuters are using the service. Can the minister please tell the member of this House, especially the member from Hamilton Stoney Creek, more about the commuters using the UP Express? Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you, Minister of Transportation.
Spadina, for the follow-up question. I also want to thank the opposition member, Speaker. You hear the excitement and the energy and the support that's coming from those on the other side of the legislature for the Union Pearson Express, Speaker. The member from Trinity Spadina is 100% right. Following some technical issues on the TTC just last week, we saw many riders jump onto the Union Pearson Express to get to their destinations on time. Because the UP Express is faster, more reliable, and less expensive than other direct airport to downtown modes of transportation, we are actually seeing commuters using the UP Express on a more regular basis. In fact, Speaker, just over 20% of the UP's ridership base is commuter-driven. We are pleased to see both commuters and air travelers taking advantage of the service, but we know that our work is not yet done. We'll continue to work with Metrolinx to build ridership by improving wayfinding and building awareness. But, Speaker, over the last year, it's clear to us that people who use the Union Pearson Express fall in love with it, Speaker, and I would encourage every member on all sides of this House to get out.
Thank you. And the question, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Yes, Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Speaker, Waterloo Region has been long blessed with some of the best health care this province has to offer, and yet government foot-dragging on a four-year-old funding promise to St. Mary's Hospital is forcing cardiac care patients to make alternative arrangements. The quality of care at St. Mary's has long drawn patients to Kitchener, but without promised funding improvements, they're at a crossroads. Back in 2012, this government promised funding to build an electrophysiology suite, and yet St. Mary's continues to wait.
John Malloy.
It's been 4 years, and as government spends millions on TV ads to boast about healthcare investments, demand for cardiovascular services at St. Mary's has soared by 25%. Will the Premier tell us if she will continue to neglect the people of Waterloo Region and St. Mary's Hospital in denying them their long-promised EP
care?
Minister of Health and
Long-Term Care. Minister of Health and
Long-Term Care. Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. It's information that I had received and had a good discussion with the member from Kitchener
Center
who has expressed the same interest in moving forward with this important cardiac development. Mr. Speaker, I have to indicate that my ministry is looking closely at this issue, working with the hospital, working with the local LIN. We know that, and it's great to see a strong advocate as well in the gallery, John Malloy, that has advocated for quite some time for these increases in services. So, Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to follow up with the ministry. I'll follow up with the members that have engaged me, including in question period this morning, with regards to future developments for this important service.
Thank you. Supplement.
Yes, and as the minister mentioned, the former member for Kitchener Centre had actually made that announcement, he'll remember, but it was 4 years ago. 4 years ago he did so. Speaker, while they've waited to deliver their promised funding, St. Mary's cardiac care wait times have become the highest in the province for some procedures, almost double that of other facilities. Mm. Patients are being forced to head elsewhere for treatment. Cardiac care physicians recruited by St. Mary's for this specific program are tired of waiting and they're heading for the exits.
Promise
government
please,
delays are having a direct impact on the health care treatment in Waterloo Region, and government doesn't seem to care. Speaker, our patience has run out. Government has had 4 years. Will the Premier commit today to end the waiting game and deliver the cardiac care funding that was promised 4 years?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I have to say I'm surprised because with this question, I would have expected at least the member opposite, if not his party, to have supported us in the budget, because the budget contained elements that precisely respond to these sorts of questions and these sorts of requirements. Not just on the immediate maintenance and renovations, which we've spoken about over the last couple of weeks, where we've increased to 170 $75 million annually for that. But the $12 billion in capital investments over the next 10 years to allow us to make these sorts of investments, which I know are important for St. Mary's, but there are other jurisdictions or other hospitals in the area that we've been working as a ministry through the lens, looking at their cardiac programs as well. So, Mr. Speaker, again, this is an issue that's been discussed between myself and the member from Kitchener Centre. I know that it's an important issue for her.
Answer.
I'm glad that the member opposite has also had the opportunity to raise it, not with me directly, but here in question period, and I'm happy to follow up with
Thank you,
Speaker.
Yeah. Question, the leader of the opposite, third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. On Saturday, I met with frontline healthcare workers and patients in North Bay. Liberal cuts have forced the North Bay Regional Health Centre to lay off over 350 nurses and hospital workers in recent years, to close beds and to cut services. It means patients leave hospital quicker and go home sicker. The hospital is understaffed, and nurses and hospital workers are stressed and they're overworked, Speaker. And the people of North Bay are paying the price for four straight years of Liberal hospital funding freezes. How can this Premier defend her record of cutting 350 workers from the North Bay Hospital?
Thank you, Premier.
Long-term care.
Minister of Health, long-term care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First off, I want to address the opposition claims that they're having 350 nurses and health care workers being cut. This number actually reflects staffing changes dating all the way back to and including the amalgamation in 2011 that resulted in a brand new hospital. So the figures that she's representing actually reflect a period of almost 6 years, Mr. Speaker, and many of the changes many of the staffing positions as a result of amalgamation were no longer, the staffing changes were a result of positions no longer required, including many administrative roles. So, Mr. Speaker, in fact, since 2011, the number of layoffs that have occurred at the North Bay Regional Health Centre amount to 21.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, this is a hospital, a brand new hospital, that was built with fewer beds than existed before it was built. That's why there's fewer staff, Speaker. Over 3 years, this government has been cutting 350 people out of the health care needs of the people of North Bay. It is the silent... Well,
the Minister of Government and Consumer Services come to order, and the Minister of Education come to order. Carry on.
Healthcare is the silent crisis of this Liberal government. The Liberals are forcing hospitals across Ontario to cut patient care, to close beds, to lay off frontline workers, all because the Liberals refuse to fund our hospitals properly. North Bay knows what that looks like, Speaker. The CEO of the hospital says he's been forced to cut $35 million in just over 3 years. And the hospital will face even more challenges this year because funding is not keeping up with inflation, population, or growing costs. Patients and families are paying the price for the Premier's cuts to health care. When will this Premier start listening to the people in North Bay and across Ontario and stop the deep Liberal cuts to hospitals and our health care?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I can think of few things worse and not demonstrative of leadership than unnecessarily and incorrectly creating anxiety among patients in North Bay. If she cared so much about...
Order. The leader of the third party will come to order. The Minister of Aboriginal Affairs will come to order. Finish, please.
Last week, Mr. Speaker, it was the member from Nipissing who erroneously spread a rumour claiming that the cancer care centre at that hospital was going to close. The hospital's in crisis mode. If the third party cared so much about the hospital in North Bay...
Go here if you want. The member from Leeds-Grenville is warned, and the member from Nipissing second time.
You have a wrap-up, please.
She cared so much about the hospital. Why didn't she even bother to call or visit the hospital when she went to North Bay? That hospital has an emergency department with wait times less than half of the national average, Mr. Speaker, a lower medical readmission rate than the provincial and national average, 86% occupancy rate,
over
3% of patients.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Start the clock. Order. Minister of Health, come to order. The member from Hamilton Mountain is warned. The leader of the third party, second time. New question, the member from Davenport.
Thank you, Speaker, and my question is for the Minister of Education. Our government recognizes that schools are the hubs of our communities across Ontario. They are places where children gather to learn and play. Since 2003, our government has invested about $13.5 billion in school infrastructure, including 758 new schools and more than 735 additions and renovations. In addition, last April, our government announced $120 million in new funding dedicated to building safe, high-quality, licensed childcare spaces in schools across the province. I understand that so far, $90 million has been allocated, resulting in almost 3,200 new licensed childcare spaces coming soon to communities across Ontario. Minister,
question.
I was pleased to join you during Education Week to make an important announcement at the Waterfront School, a vibrant community hub here in Toronto. Speaker, through you to the Minister,
thank you.
Please tell this House how our government...
I stand you sick. Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you, Speaker, and I want to thank the member for her important advocacy for community hubs, including the Bloor-Dufferin site in her riding. Our government is committed, Speaker, to supporting the use of schools as community hubs, which integrate a range of needed services under one roof to better serve the communities. This year, Ontario is investing nearly $90 million to expand childcare and child and family support services in schools and create spaces in schools for community use. As part of this investment, our government will provide $20 million to create spaces for new child care and family support programs in schools, $18 million to retrofit existing space within schools to open up more child care, $50 million to renovate surplus schools, or surplus school space to make it available
for
new community hubs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And Minister, it is great to hear our government continues to improve community access and increase services offered in schools. Ontario's nearly 5,000 schools offer the ideal location for community hubs, as many of them are the heart of their community. As the minister referred and mentioned, the Bloor-Dufferin site in my riding of Davenport as a great example of a great location for a vibrant community hub. And the one that we visited during Education Week, the Waterfront School, a vibrant community hub that also includes a neighbourhood centre, school and child centre all in one location. All these investments are part of our government's economic plan to build Ontario up and deliver on its number one priority, growing the economy and creating jobs. Minister, can you tell us, including my constituents in Davenport, how our government is making it easier for community partners to create community hubs in schools?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. One of the things we're doing is we're expanding eligibility for school capital funding to include building replacement space for community partners in new schools or additions if the original school where their community hub was located is closed. Some of the other things we're doing, Speaker, is making it easier for community partners to create community hubs by giving them additional warning if they could have a future opportunity to purchase or lease surplus school space. We've added to the list of people who will be notified. The list now includes local health integration networks, children's mental health agencies, First Nation and Métis organizations, and in Northern Ontario, District Social Service Administration Boards. They told us that only municipalities were notified. We've added the DSABs at their request. We're also making sure that they have longer to respond. All these organizations will have an additional 90 days so that they have longer to try and work out arrangements with the school board.
Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga has given notice of his dissatisfaction with the answer to his question given by the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care concerning St. Mary's Hospital. This matter will be debated tomorrow at 6 p.m. Government House Leader on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I believe we have unanimous consent to put forward a motion without notice with respect to private members' public bills.
The Government House Leader is seeking unanimous consent to put forward a motion without notice. Do we agree? Agreed. Government House Leader.
Speaker, I move that notwithstanding the order of the House dated Monday, May 30, 2016, the Standing Committee on Justice Policy be authorized to meet on Monday, June 6, 2016 from 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. for a clause-by-clause consideration of Bill 149, an act to establish an advisory committee to make recommendations on the jury recommendations made in the inquest into the death of Rowan Stringer, Bill 180, an act to proclaim a Workers' Day of Mourning, and Bill 182, an act to proclaim Ontario Down Syndrome Day.
Mr. Nagby moves that notwithstanding the order, dispense. Do we agree?
Agree.
Carry. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.